How you doing, Jamie? You all right?
Yeah, good. Yeah, good at the moment. Been through some stuff recently, health stuff, but I'm getting back on form. So back at the gym,
Okay.
exercising.
Yeah, wonderful. It's been a long time since we've talked, and I know we chat a lot on Facebook, and we've got a lot to catch up on. I want to give our audience a heads up on the kind of themes that we're going to be covering. You're a hypnotherapist. You help people with ADHD, and you've got your own journey and your own story with ADHD and mental health. And we're going to talk about the electromagnetic topic as well. But
EMFs, yeah.
So it's up to you where you want to start off, really. What have you been up to recently? I think that's a good place.
Maybe not start there because I might end up diving into all the EMF stuff, and I thought that might be something to kind of leave nearish, more near the end,
Okay.
because that's kind of quite a specific thing to talk about, I guess. But just to talk about, I suppose, ADHD. So I was. Obviously, well, not obviously. Some people can develop ADHD later in life, apparently. And we live in, I guess, what is kind of like an ADHD culture now. It's like an ADHD world. You go on the internet, you're on your computer, and there's all these pages open, and you kind of get distracted, and your phone's ringing, and then blah, blah, blah. But I always had ADHD. And it was in 2004, I was aged 24. And I was in a relationship at the time, and the funny thing was, my girlfriend at the time was looking at being diagnosed for Asperger syndrome, which is, I'm not sure they call that anymore, call it Asperger syndrome, but it's a kind of like what some people think of as a mild or high functioning autism. And I came across a book called Driven to Distraction by Dr. Rattay. And I'm reading that book, and suddenly, well, I say suddenly, I mean by the throughout the book, the whole way through, it's like, oh my God, this is describing my life. And it reduced me to tears because there was one, I remember reading one thing in there where it said about a child that would, this boy that would always do things that he was told not to do. He was the one who always get into trouble. He was like the class clown. And that was me all over. But then obviously all the other things like difficulties concentrating, hyperactivity, temper tantrums. I had really bad anger when I was younger. All these kinds of things. I had all of the symptoms of ADHD according to this book I was reading. I didn't know about ADHD at that point. I used to call it insatiability disorder, because one of the ways I understand my ADHD is that it's like you're just not satisfied. So a lot of people with ADHD, they've done research around this, like this idea of a novelty gene. So you get a lot of people that are attracted to like extreme sports and anything that's kind of exciting or dangerous. And so researchers were looking at this possibility of what they call a novelty gene. And funnily enough, people with ADHD, a lot of us are would kind of we're kind of similar to that, where a lot of us are attracted to exciting things, dangerous things, extreme sports. Personally, I'm not myself, but I've noticed similarities where I need a lot of stimulation just to feel alive, and that's why I call it insatiability disorder. So you'll see some of ADHD and they're like hyperactive, but it's like I'm hyperactive inside my brain too. It's like I'm constantly wanting to find out the answers to something. It's like having Googleitis. Like where there's a question and you're like, oh my God, get on Google. I need to know the answer now. It's kind of like that. And I can become obsessed by a topic and just go into it like so deep. But anyway, it was 2004 and she was going to see Simon Baron Cohen, Ali G's brother, who's like the UK expert on Asperger's and mild autism, or sorry, high functioning autism, I should say. And yeah, so she was seeing him for a possible diagnosis. And I came across this book about ADHD. And suddenly it was right, insatiability disorder is now known as attention deficit and hyperactivity disorder. A term I don't prefer that term. I come up with my own. But so what happened was we swapped. She had a book by Simon Baron Cohen. And she gave me that. And at the end of the book, there were kind of like a paper and pencil test where you answer these questions. And there were these things like where pictures of people's faces and their eyes, and you had to kind of interpret their facial expressions. without being able to see their, I think it was their eyes were covered. That was it. And so she gave me that book and I gave her my, like, it wasn't a test. It was just like a questionnaire to score you on your likelihood of ADHD, you know, if you kind of, so it's just like kind of like answering questions on a scale of 1 to 5. Do you tend to forget things? Do you tend to be late? That kind of stuff.
Mm.
And I got a score of around about 30, I think about 33 or something on there. And I would redo the tests on different days and still get around basically the same score.
Mm.
And so she does that test and I do her tests. And then just to complicate matters, we kind of share our results. And it turns out it was kind of hilarious and kind of scary at the same time that I had much higher results on the scale of autism than she did. And she had much higher results on ADHD than I did.
Right.
So it's kind of like, oh my God, I've just like discovering that I may have this thing called ADHD. But then it's like, do I also have autism? And it was kind of, you know, getting more complicated. And what happened was, I was kind of very stressed at the time. And, throughout my life, I used to lose a lot of jobs. And I lost, work at the time. And then we ended up breaking up. And, and it was the same time I also was being diagnosed and I ended out of work for like 10 years and it was just kind of like this horrible, dark part of my life. Mm. And so I went to see the doctor and I was surprised. It was quite a quick process. He said, okay, I'll send you to a specialist, sort of specialist. Turn up at this place in Bristol. It was kind of like really ominous looking, this kind of complex I went into, thought I'm going to get lost in there. managed to find him. He turns up. He's like a basketball player. He's like really tall, shakes my hand and I feel like puny. and yeah, he says, come into my office. And what happened was, you know, he had the results from the questionnaire. I think he spoke to my mum asking about my childhood to find out if I had this since I was young, which I did. And they also ran like IQ testing and testing of my reaction times and my ability to kind of not be reactive, that kind of thing, not to be impulsive.
All right.
So, yeah, so did all of that. And of course, like, whoa, what's going on? And so I see him a few weeks later and comes back and he says, I'm satisfied that you have attention deficit disorder with hyperactivity. So today they call it ADHD just because it's just easier to call it ADHD. But people will say there's like different subtypes. So some people will have ADD, but they're not hyperactive. And some people will be, just have ADD without hyperactivity. But I had both. And very hyper, lots of energy when I was younger. And so he said that. And to be honest, Ben, I didn't want to take medication. I've never really been that kind of person because I remember my dad taking a headache tablet. And he said, I said, Dad, it can't work that quick. He'd take the tablet and it would work within seconds. His headache would disappear.
Hmm.
And I've always been into kind of like complementary alternative stuff growing up. And I was aware of like concepts about placebo effect and that kind of thing. And I said, I just think it's really in your mind. It can't work that quick. He said, yeah, it does. It's like in the advert. It hits pain fast where it hurts. And in the advert, there's like a bow and arrow. I can't remember. It's a bow and arrow or something like that. And it fires and hits the goal.
Oh, the marketing works then.
Yeah. So, but also marketing is a form of hypnosis, right? So it was kind of like, wow. So I think it's mostly, I'm not saying it doesn't work, but it sounds like in your case, it was mostly placebo. It was working before it was meant to work. And I thought, well, I know the mind's powerful. And at the age of, because my anger problems, even before my diagnosis, I put myself in psychotherapy to deal with my anger problems. And that was quite effective. And I said to the doctor, I'm the kind of person, you know, that will make every effort to kind of to manage and hopefully master this ADHD. Medication for me is like, you know, the be all and end all. And for me, it's the last thing rather than the first thing.
Hmm.
But I was kind of lost because of endlessly losing jobs and not being able to keep relationships and all the various problems that came with ADHD. And this typically often happens. So I'm there and suddenly I just went quiet and he gave me the prescription for methylphenidate or Ritalin once per day. It was it once per day, and I took the prescription and I went off to the doctors and took my meds. And unfortunately, in my case, apparently most people, a lot of people have a good response. And some people need to keep taking different medications to find one that works. But in my case, I had really bad side effects. But I want people to know that this isn't typical. Because when I tell my story, it's kind of like, oh, is he just like now trying to scare everyone by talking about his story? But I feel it's important to share my story. Because it's one story of ADHD. And I took the medication, and what happened was I was having headaches. I was dehydrated. Doctor said, well, drink more water, but I was drinking like a fish. He said, chew gum. But I was like, I didn't really want to chew gum, but that didn't work either. And I was becoming dizzy a lot, and there was a lot of physical problems, like heart palpitations. So I came off my medication. It actually got really bad. If I go into that, I became really depressed and stuff as well.
Well, whilst on the medication?
Yeah. I tried to take my own life because I ended up homeless at that point. So I'm not attributing all of it to the medication either, because it is complex. For example, I just found out from reading more stuff by Dr. Rahty, and he himself has ADHD, and he's kind of like pro-medication, but he's also pro-exercise and taking a holistic approach to ADHD rather than just relying on medication. And he says, like, if someone doesn't want to take medication, the likelihood of side effects actually increases. Now, that's really interesting, because I clearly didn't want to take medication, but I took it because I felt like there was nothing else to do or nothing else available, and that's what he offered me. And I was like, okay, this is what's being offered. I said, is there some kind of therapy? And he said, well, most of my clients take medication and most of them stay on it. And I was like, wow, I thought you only did it short term. So, but what happened was I was at the Salvation Army in Bristol. I was homeless at the time. And I was there roughly for about 6 months. So what happened was it was in the morning. I took my medication, it was at breakfast, and I just suddenly became really angry and ran up the stairs. And I threw myself at the window, the third story of the building, and the staff were chasing me up the stairs. They kicked the door in and actually managed to grab me as I hit glass. The glass cracked. I bruised my face and there was blood, and I survived. quite a horrible beginning to all of this.
What period of time was that?
What do you mean, what period of time?
I mean, what year was that?
That was in 2004 when I was 24 years old.
Oh, okay.
So what happened was I decided medication isn't working for me. And that was kind of scary again, because it seemed like to be the only thing available, certainly at the time. And if you look at the statistics, most people with ADHD only ever take medication in adults, and in children it's not much better either. It's around about, I think it's more like, well, in the UK anyway, maybe about 50% of children get some kind of therapy in addition to medication. So in adults, it's almost 100% of adults just take medication. So I'm not saying that it's not helpful. I'm just saying it's not enough. And what happened was I came off my medication, and then it was, well, what the heck do I do now? And this is where my kind of journey began in kind of coming to some kind of solution around this. So it was pretty dark for years and years and years. One of the pluses was, because I was homeless and because of my diagnosis of ADHD and depression, that I, at that time, I guess it was easier. You see so many people on the streets today.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tons of people on the streets now. I think today, if what happened back then when I was 24 happened today, I don't think this would have happened. But within 6 months of being at Salvation Army, I was offered my own flat by the council. So I managed to have, I had somewhere to stay.
Yeah.
And what happened was between 2004 and 2011, I was just kind of miserable and depressed, basically.
Hey, I've got a question. Like, what's the situation? How come you couldn't stay with your parents or something?
Oh, well, home life, to be honest, home life was pretty challenging. And my parents broke up at a certain point. And it was very stressful at home. So that wasn't really, that didn't, well, what should I say? That didn't help.
Okay.
that wasn't working. And so anyway, so this happens, and what happens is so I'm there, I'm just depressed, and I'm just kind of like, oh, I got ADHD, I'm depressed, and getting up every day, I've got ADHD and nothing's really working for me and blah blah blah, and just wasting my life away. And then in 2006, someone walks into my life, and it was who I consider to be, I never really had a best friend, I felt like, when I was growing up, but this was like my best friend, Sarah Bailey. And I'd been into hypnosis since I was young, and meditation. And she turns up, and she's an NLP master. So she trained in NLP, and she trained in hypnotherapy. I mean, I've been learning from books and doing self-hypnosis for years, but here she is. And I'm like, wow, this person comes into my life. And she's really, I don't know, she's just kind of like a person you just feel like loved, and you just feel safe in their presence. And the other thing was, she was literally like a coach to me as well as a friend. And when I got down and got negative and so on, she would be there to pick me up. She would be there to challenge me out of my negativity. Hmm. And as time went by, we'd kind of do that for each other. She'd get down sometimes and I'd challenge her. You know, it's like it's easier to kind of say the right things for someone else. But then when it's you, you kind of like, so it's kind of like that. And it was kind of up and down after 2004 and 2006. It was kind of up and down. And then what happened was, so I've got this positive influence in my life, and she introduced me to other positive people. And you know yourself, Ben, that having positive people around you is so, so important.
Yeah.
And then I'm starting to think about going back to work, but it's kind of scary. Because overall, I hadn't worked pretty much like, in the end, it was around about 10 years. And it was kind of scary. It was like an alien thing by then. And things were kind of, in a way, cushy. It was like, I always had benefits being paid for, it was kind of like, well, I had somewhere to stay. My rent was being paid for, blah, blah, blah. Because I listen to a lot of Jordan Peterson these days. And it's kind of like he says, if you don't like, there's no risk to take if you just sit at home playing computer games and just flunking, being a dropout, it's not great, but there's no risk involved and there's no effort that you need to put in. And it was kind of like that. But I'm at this crossroads. And Sarah said to me one day, she quoted Tony Robbins.
Yeah.
Anthony Robbins. And if anyone doesn't know, he's like considered by people like the world's number one coach. In fact, he's the guy that started coaching. He's the one that came up with this name of coaching.
Yeah.
And she quoted him, and he said, the quote was, change happens when the fear of staying the same outweighs the fear of change. And that just did it for me. That just switched on a light bulb in my mind and in my heart. And every time that I started to think to kind of want to go back to an easier life and not progress and just kind of like not make that decision and move forward, I would have that quote ringing in my brain,
Yeah.
I'd imagine Tony Robbins saying it to me. And I was like, right, things might seem like I'm just going to have to do this. It was kind of like there's a bridge where I want to get to seems so like over here, so like far away. And how do I get to there from where I am right now? And it's like, well, I got to build that bridge. So for starters, I just need to go back to work. I need to get back on my feet. And one of the things I did was I started I volunteered, first of all, for a couple of years in a unit in a school. They had like an autistic unit in a mainstream school.
Hmm.
And I worked with children with autism, ADHD for a couple of years. And that was absolutely wonderful. And then from there, it was like, okay, well, I think I need to, get paid work. And I did. So I then began working with adults with learning disabilities, mostly with autism. But it wasn't kind of ideally what I wanted to do. And then it was, okay, but this is a stepping stone. And I'm now contributing, doing something worthwhile rather than just being depressed at home. And basically, yeah, but what happened was, I didn't really say this, but in 2011, so this is when I went back to work. In 2011, it was like a transformation. What happened was I also started to I was into meditation since I was very young. But I came across something called iAwake. It's a form of meditation technology or sound technology, which I started to use. And my meditations went from kind of just, oh, well, this is interesting, kind of a bit trippy sometimes, to, wow, this is actually working. And I was experiencing what people then were starting to call mindfulness, but this was happening spontaneously without any training. And I had what I consider to be like, I suppose people call like an awakening. It was like my past just went up in smoke. It was like, that's just something that happened to someone else. That's just a story. And who I am today, it's not dependent upon the past. And I literally came out of meditation one day, and that was what I was experiencing. But I also got into exercise. And it was Ken Wilber. If anyone's heard of Ken Wilber, he's like the philosopher of philosophers. I heard him say, he said that people that meditate and exercise, like if you're doing weight training, but you then take up meditation, or you're a meditator and you take up weight training, either way, you will get better results in both departments. And there's, you can explain it in simple terms, like maybe it's just because you're getting more oxygen into your body and blah, blah, blah. But there's something else that there seems to be some kind of synergy. It's because human beings are mind, body, and soul. So we work on this kind of like different levels, but they all work together. And so suddenly, like I said, I think with the aid of I Awake and the fact that I was exercising, my practice went to another level. It was like, so when I went to the gym and I came back and I was to meditate, I found that I could concentrate like I never concentrated before. And lots of things were improving. And I came out of my depression in that same year. By the summer, I was out of my depression. It lifted like a fog bank or a clouds lifting, literally. I'm not saying it happened overnight like magic like that, but there was certainly a process going on. And it was things I've been doing over time, but there was this transformation, that this big shift, that I was no longer depressed.
So it's the introduction of exercise and meditation that did that.
It was combining things, Ben. It was combining these things together. And one of the inspirations for that, I guess, was Ken Wilber, because it's one of the things he talks about. Because we are, in a sense, triune beings, we're mind, body, and soul. You know, when you combine things together, it's like you could do a big, long weight training session during the week, and you can have a massive long meditation on another day. But if you actually bring these things together, so if you were to do even smaller chunks of like 10 minutes exercise, 10 minutes of meditation, 10 minutes of goal setting, or whatever it is you do, and you bring all that together, you actually get some kind of synergistic effect from the practices all working together, because you're exercising all of your, what he calls, all of your bodies. We have a physical body, we have a subtle energy body, in this kind of idea, we have different states of consciousness. So we're actually exercising all of it simultaneously rather than separately. You know quite a bit about, you know, exercise and that kind of thing. So, I mean, some people argue, it depends on the individual where they are in their training, but some people argue like doing a whole body workout can maybe be in some ways be superior to kind of training different body parts on different days. It kind of reminds me of that. It's kind of like I'm training my whole body rather than just training these things separately, and they're working together in the way that they're meant to work together. So a lot of the training that I've being attracted to in the gym, it's kind of like more athletic training. So I use weights and stuff, but a lot of body weight stuff, and it all kind of, yeah, it's kind of like working the whole body. And anyway, he was the inspiration for that. So I'm at the gym, you know, scary going to the gym, you're a skinny little guy, and I go in there but you know, I just kept pushing myself. And after a few weeks, I'm like, I love going to the gym. And I believe that the transformation I had was because I was doing all these things, and exercise was definitely a key one. Dr. Russell Barkley, an expert on ADHD, he says that ADHD responds, out of all of the kind of mental health disorders, ADHD responds the most to exercise.
Right.
And in terms of depression, so with depression, it's 1/3 of people will respond to medication, 1/3 of people will respond to psychotherapy, but everyone responds to exercise when depressed. If you can, of course, get them to exercise, that's a different matter. But if you can get them to do it.
I didn't know that.
Responds to exercise. But like I said, it's the combination too, like the exercise combined with the meditation and the other things I was doing. Like changing my thoughts, the coaching with Sarah, the hypnosis. Now, all these things, when you combine them, that's when you start to kind of get the kind of what seems like the transformational magical shift that people are after. The where a lot of us have kind of gone wrong, I suppose, is that we tried different things and maybe gave up on them and moved on to something else. Hmm. So for me, that was like the magic. That was the key, certainly it for me anyway. And in 2011, it was I went from depressed and suicidal and out of work on benefits to going back to work. I was cycling 20 miles a day because I, you know, that was my way of getting to work. I was crazy. 20 miles a day, so 120 a week average. I was going to the gym for the first time in my life. I was meditating because of using iAwake, which made my meditation so much more effective, easy, and enjoyable. I was meditating like hours, at least an hour or so a day. And also because I had some money from starting work, I went and trained as a clinical hypnotherapist. And the kind of the mindset I got from that and the things I learned about the brain and what they call neuroplasticity, the ability of the brain to actually make changes, even when it's, shall we say, the brain appears to be damaged. Like all of that together just, you know, just pulled me out. But it wasn't until recently, like a few years ago, that I realized that I should specialize in ADHD. Up until then, I was kind of a generalizer. Mm-hmm. It was just kind of that risk thing about, oh, but if I... 50% of people we talk to say, well, yeah, but if you do that, then you might lose a lot of customers. And then the other half of people say, no, you'll actually attract more people, or at least attract certain people, and they'll want, you know, they'll be attracted to you rather than you're trying to kind of fight over scraps. But for me, that's been a big part of the process too, is specializing in ADHD from 2 years ago. It's suddenly I have to kind of become more conscious of things that I've done, that I've learned about my process, and also keep abreast of latest research and stuff, and to help other people with the same problems that I've tackled. And to be honest, still tackling. It's not like, oh, I've, you know, like I'm, you know, it's still kind of a part of my, it's hard to explain. It's like still part of my life. If anyone said, do you feel like your ADHD is gone? I would say, well, depends what you mean by ADHD. I have good days and bad days, but I know what it is I need to do to have a good day. Just like anyone, the day where you don't bother to go to the gym or don't bother to eat healthy, blah, 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 you probably end up with your own problems, where it's just you feel sluggish, tired, so you don't perform so well at work. We can all get like that. And I get like it too, but I'm aware of how my own unique brain and biology, and what it is I need to do to optimize it.
Yeah. So give us a rundown of your perfect day in terms of what has to happen in order for you to feel really good.
Wow, that's a brilliant question. So a little insight into how I kind of manage ADHD. So a perfect day for me would be the night before. What I do is I write a to-do list. So I write this down on a piece of paper. I'm very old fashioned. So I write down on a piece of paper, very big and dark pen, so I can see it really clearly. And I just put the day, so I know what the day is tomorrow. So it says, today's what? So I did one, so today's Wednesday. It says Wednesday. And then I will write down hour by hour what I will be doing. It doesn't have to fit that time frame exactly, but it's like I'm giving my brain the ability to kind of get a sense of time, because one of the things of ADHD, and I also noticed with a lot of the children I work with autism, is a poor sense of time. So by doing this, you're planning, you're getting your executive functions in front of your brain working, your inner organizer, and then you're writing down hour by hour everything that you're going to do. So what this does is you've done it before bed, and then you put it there next to your alarm clock. And what that does, it activates the same part of your brain that is said to be lagging in ADHD, the organizational time part of the brain. So you've exercised that part of your brain before sleep. And then when you go into sleep, you're effectively putting yourself into a state which has many similarities with hypnosis. It's a trance state. So when you go into a dream, one of the functions of a dream is to program your brain. So I believe by doing it before sleep, you leave a stronger kind of imprint in your dream phase, your REM, yeah, when you're sleeping,
right? So it's like the list, it sort of becomes a hypnotic suggestion in your sleep or something.
Yes, so I call it the hypnotic to-do list. And then what I do is I write that, and also I put it next to my alarm clock, literally right next to it, Now, a lot of people with ADHD will find it difficult to get out of bed, and they'll kind of snooze all the time. One of the simple things you can do is to put your alarm away from your bed, so you have to get out of bed to get it.
Mm.
Just switch it off, that kind of thing. So I put it away from the bed, but I can still, if I look over in the morning when it goes off, I can see it. Now, I, of course, because the alarm is where the to-do list is, I will look in that same direction. Now, some of the children I've worked with autism and ADHD will often have lists. Some are, if autism is profound, and a lot of the children I work with, by the way, have both autism and ADHD. They often have like dual diagnosis.
Okay.
So they'll have, maybe have like a load of pictures. And some are more kind of like OCD than others. It literally, each single task they do has to be there, every single one. And some find it hard, difficult to deviate from it. Now, one of the reasons for that is because it stops a lot of the anxiety and it gives them a sense of time. And, you know, and so... That's basically what I do. So I write the list, and then it's where my alarm clock is. I'm going to wake up and I'm going to look over where the alarm clock is. And just like the children that I work with, I'm going to look over and see my list. And I'm going to, first thing I do when I wake up is I see the list. Now I make sure, because a lot of people with ADHD and people generally, a lot of people end up despising to-do lists.
Hmm.
Now when I suggest this to a client with ADHD, they go, Oh no, it doesn't really work for me. I don't like them. And then I find out that what they do is they put loads of stuff on their list. There's all stuff that they have to do, that they should do, rather than what about the stuff that you want to do? Now, so what you do is you have at least one thing at the beginning of your list that you want to wake up for. That is important because, like Russell Barkley, an expert on ADHD, Dr. Russell Barkley says, he says, like, you know, ADHD isn't so much an attention issue, but a motivational challenge. So your attention can waver. You can have poor attention and focus and follow through because you're not really motivated.
Right.
So what I do is I make sure on my ADHD friendly to-do list, the first thing it has is something I want to do. I got to get out of bed for a reason. Something I can't just get out of bed. Right. If it was a job I didn't want to do, it wouldn't be enough to get out of bed for a job I didn't want to do. Now, a lot of people can do that.
Right.
When you have ADHD, you just can't do it.
So there's like an exaggerated effect, like the stuff that you don't want to do, it's like you're really not going to do it, and then the stuff you really do want to do, you're going to really want to do it. Is that how it is?
In simple terms, but it can get a little bit more complex. There are instances where people with ADHD will say there's something I want to do, but I still can't do it. Mm. But in my experience, that has been, for example, it might be where something they want to do involves, they might want to go to university and study a subject. For example, it's quite academic, but they might find certain aspects of it, like the reading, a chore, or they struggle reading. Some people with ADHD can have a dual diagnosis of dyslexia. It's more common to have dyslexia with ADHD. Mm. So they're struggling with the reading aspect of it, but they still want to do that, if you see what I mean.
Right.
But that can, of course, encourage you to put in more effort and to kind of get past your blocks and so on. So kind of yes and no. But certainly, a lot of the attentional difficulties we see with ADHD is often things they just don't want to do. But where it's not just a case of, oh, well, that's just kind of like being selfish and childish. You just want to do the things that you want to do.
Mm.
Yeah. You just want to eat the cake.
Mm.
It's not, because one of the things we also see with ADHD is what we call hyper-focus. Now, that can be good. If you're hyper-focused on something that you can't pull yourself away from something, but you're going to get loads of work done, but that can cause just as much problems as finding it difficult to focus.
Right.
So the thing with ADHD is not so much inability to concentrate. It's mismanagement of attention. So it's kind of like you can concentrate on something, but you can't not walk away from it. So it's almost like addictive.
I see.
And then on the other hand, it can be you just can't get yourself to concentrate whatsoever. So it's kind of this big fluctuation from one end of the scale to the other.
Mm.
There's not much middle ground. And that's a lot of what we see of ADHD, not much middle ground.
I see.
It's extremes. But go on, I'm getting lost in this. But yeah, where were we? On the perfect day kind of thing. So yeah, I do the to-do list. And I see it there. It's on the alarm clock. I study it. So I look at it. And I've noticed. So you wake up and you look at it and you read what you're going to do. And you actually feel calmer, and you feel more awake just by reading that to-do list, because suddenly what you've done is you've switched on the front of the brain, the logical part, which also gives a release of dopamine. So that's what medication achieves, but there are many, many ways that we can do that in addition to medication. So yeah. So literally having a to-do list and doing it in the way that I do it, what I call the hypnotic to-do list, is one way to increase the dopamine and get yourself prepared to get out of bed and get on with your day. But the other thing I do, I've got loads of little tricks. For example, another trick I do is I kind of use another kind of hypnotic type technique to actually wake me up in the morning. But it's a similar kind of thing, really. It's based in motivation. And then my perfect day is, so on my list, it will be, okay, I'm going to get up. Now, I do enjoy meditation. Some people say, oh, that's boring, but what's interesting is meditation also increases dopamine, just like exercise does. So I get up and I meditate, and that increases my dopamine. I also have a little neat trick. It's like a little gadget that I came across in 2003 when I wanted to go to university. And I decided to help me concentrate. I got this little gadget, and it's – I don't know if you've heard of them, Ben. They're called Mind Machines.
No, what's that?
Okay, so they're kind of, their technical term is audio visual entrainment. Entrainment means to entrain or to follow. So it's like if you listen to music, your brain's following the beat, right?
Mm.
It's the sound. But these machines will use light and sound, and some do more than that. But normally they use light and sound. And so it will have lights inside the glasses that you put up the glasses on, and there's these little miniature LEDs. More recent machines like this have, some of them have LCD type screens. You can do them with your eyes open or closed. Most are open, eyes closed. And what it is, you close your eyes and these lights flicker. And the one I have, for example, the Procyon, produces millions of shades of color, and it will flicker on and off like a strobe, but it will also pulse, and it will shift smoothly from one color to another. And what it does, for example, if you want to wake up in the morning and you need a lot of stimulation, right? This machine will, using light and sound, will cause the brain to follow the frequency of the light and the sound. And so the setting I use is amazing at getting you up. It's I would say it's as good, if not better, than coffee, because there's no crash. There's no negative side effect.
Did you put it on your head like a headset, like a pair of goggles or something?
It's like a pair of goggles, and you close your eyes, and you choose the program you want. So if you want to wake yourself up, and if you've got ADHD, you need to use a setting that's going to make you wake up. And it will use color therapy, so it will use red lights, yellow, kind of those strong kind of colors to wake you up. And the lights will go at a certain speed. If it wants to wake you up, the lights will go fast. And depending on... If, for example, people with hyperactivity, believe it or not, people think that when you have ADHD, that your brain is really fast. It's not, it's the other way around. The front of the brain is going too slow. And the children that, or adults with ADHD that have hyperactivity, their brain goes even slower than people with ADD.
So why is that then?
I know, it's crazy. Some people have thought, well, maybe it's an indication of a form of brain damage, because when the front of the brain moves slowly, produces slower brain waves, it could be an indication of some form of brain damage. But I've seen other research, for example, the possibility that because they see this mostly on the right-hand side of the brain. Now, the right-hand side of the brain is the creative, considered the creative side of the brain. And so it's possible that what you're actually seeing is a kind of a bias in certain people's brains that maybe because people with ADHD, apart from their symptoms that we see, their personality tends to be creative, intuitive, entrepreneurial, energetic, and sensitive. Those for me are the five key qualities that you find in people with ADHD.
I'm imagining like the creative genius who's got very little sort of patience or attention span, but is very focused on a particular task or a particular project. That's what I'm imagining.
Yes. Yeah, that sounds like a description that might fit a lot of people with ADHD. I mean, Thomas Edison, when you say that, it reminded me of Thomas Edison for some reason. But of course, a lot of people say that although he wasn't diagnosed and this wasn't really known about back then, but he could be an example of someone with the condition. And he didn't do very well in school, but his mum pulled him out of school.
I guess
had him in the laboratory.
I guess this is why there's a lot of high achievers that perhaps I can't remember which version of this it is, like autism or whatever, but like a lot of people at the top are extremely narrowly focused on one thing, which is why they become successful at it, I suppose.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Yeah, that's certainly, yeah, I'd agree with you on that. Yeah. Although one of the things with that is that, like, yeah, you can, like you say, you can kind of like specialize, and that will help you get really far in the pursuit that you're focused on. Now, certainly you do need some specialization to be able to kind of to be at the top of your game in that area, right? Mm-hmm. To achieve your most in that area. If you want to be a musician, then you need to at least 10,000 hours to kind of get your brain to switch into that kind of natural, spontaneous, musical kind of brain that you want to create for yourself. But so that is true. But just kind of taking from the work of Ken Wilber and what's called integral theory, if you wanted to see some big leaps in your development, even if you're specializing in a certain area, you also want to take a look at your weaknesses. And so that's part of my philosophy of ADHD, is strengths first, weaknesses second. So we focus on strengths first because that makes you feel good about yourself. Hmm. You know, Ben is good at handstands. So hey, Ben, you got ADHD, but you're good at handstands. So it's like, okay, so what qualities about Ben are, you know, where are you doing really well? And what are the strong points that you have? Now, if we focus on those, you're going to feel good about yourself. You're going to have higher self-esteem. Now, because we did it that way round, rather than people saying to you, oh, you keep forgetting this and you keep not doing this and doing that, and you hear that throughout your lifetime, if you have ADHD, you will hear that, like, I don't know, it's ridiculous number of times you'll hear it. In an average day, you might hear it 10, 20 times.
Like constant criticism.
It's like, yeah, it ends up feeling like, and it's not that people necessarily criticizing, but they don't know you have ADHD, or even if they do, they don't know what ADHD is, right, and they don't know how best to help you. And the way that we normally deal with it, we tell people, we keep reminding them, we say, look, you forgot to do this, do this, do that. But that can drive some of the ADHD insane, because they know that, just, and they've been told it a million and one times. Right. But do you think if I tell you another time, and we've already told you a million times, that last time is going to make a difference? No, it doesn't work like that. Like, the person really has to want, first of all, to change. And most people with ADHD, of course, they want to kind of, they know that something's going on. Or if some people don't, but when they get to that point, they know there's something going on, then they find out what it is. And then it's like, hey, I want to do something about it. But then the question is how? But yeah, anyway, strengths first, and then weaknesses second, because it is also important to address our weaknesses. Because we could just end up capitalizing on our strengths and ignoring our weaknesses, which I don't think makes for a very well-rounded individual. Mm. But what is interesting about that, though, is, so there's been examples in schools where they've got children, say, with their weaknesses, like they're not doing very well at maths and English, say. I can't remember the name of the school. There's a school in the States where one of the things about ADHD, and we're not great on details a lot of the time. We're good at big pictures, but not details. Mm. So I forgot the name of the school. But what happened was the headmaster, rather than spend like tens of thousands of pounds on getting that child a diagnosis and then having special lessons and you know, an extra help in the classroom, what he did was he took a different approach to children falling behind. And many of these children would have been diagnosed with conditions like ADHD, by the way. Hmm. What he did was different. He said, no, what we're going to do, we're going to focus on their strengths first. And so say one child, they said, well, what are you interested in? What do you love to do? And the child was like, okay, I like films, movies. They're like, okay, cool. What if we got you like some equipment and you were to make your own films? And so this child starts to make their own films, and they present this movie to the school that they made. And of course, they got other kids involved and teachers maybe in the making of the movie. So it's a group project as well. And present it to the school. And of course, everyone's clapping. This is amazing. And their self-esteem's going up. They're also capitalizing on their strengths. But what is really interesting is this. The child's weaknesses in, say, maths and English, they found in each instance when they did this that they would improve,
right,
in those subjects. So there's something, and this kind of, for me, it comes back to this thing about ADHD, like what I said earlier about a lot of people can just get out of bed and go to a job they hate, come home. Actually, I'm paraphrasing a client months ago that actually said this to me, come home, put their feet up, put on EastEnders, and then go to sleep that night.
Mm.
Some people just can't do it. In fact, the same client said they had a high paid job, they're doing really well, and they're looking at all of everyone else in the same job, they seem to be happy, but they said they felt like there was still something missing. And this is why I talk a lot about the need for meaning, identifying a person's meaning in life, you know, like goals and their values, that kind of thing, because you need to kind of leverage those to get that person the motivation they need to be able to do the kind of what they feel like is the boring, small, everyday tasks.
Yeah.
For example, I had a client recently want to set up a business, but it's like, but they got to do all these things that they find boring. They love all the ideas they get, the things that they're inventing in their mind. But then when it comes to setting the business up, all those kind of things, they're kind of like, oh my God, this is such a drag. So you have to kind of leverage the creative side of it, the meaning, the value. Now it's there, and it's there in all of us, but we don't necessarily identify what that is. We don't necessarily get it down on paper and understand and get a conscious appreciation of it.
Yeah.
But when you do that, what you do is what I call, manufacturing dopamine or coercing dopamine, because once you identify it, just by identifying it and then plugging in those, your bigger picture into the small steps, you create like almost like a funnel effect. And it's like the dopamine can now kind of trickle down from the top of the mountain down to where you are at the bottom walking up.
Mm.
Already getting stressed out going, oh, how can I ever get to my goal up there? I got to do all these boring things. down them, you know.
I'm with you. Yeah, I'm with you. Right. So you I understand what you mean. You set yourself up. You use the things that do make you feel good, that do put you in a resourceful state, in order to sort of help you do the tasks that need doing as well. Yeah.
Now, what is, if you don't have ADHD, you may not need to do that. You might just, like I said, you might just find it easy, or whatever you want to call it. You can just do that. You don't need to go and have a diagnosis or take a medication, Ritalin to help you to get out of bed and get to work. Like, you can just do it. But when you have ADHD, it's like you can. And the way around it, apart from medication, is to leverage the meaning in your life, to get your motivation, and to plug in the big stuff with the small stuff, and then you're more likely to do it.
So perhaps it's like with ADHD, it's all extreme, isn't it, and exaggerated. Those things that are at play, maybe everybody is the same for everybody, but the effects are perhaps not noticeable because it's more subtle.
Yeah.
And so, you know, they might be in a slightly bad mood or a slightly lethargic state, or they might just be finding their life a little bit sort of sluggish. And so perhaps they're just floating along in the middle. But with ADHD, it's like one extreme to the other. So I suppose you really get to see the effects of different things. So maybe like everyone can apply the same principles. It's just the results are more noticeable when you've got that condition.
Exactly, Ben. One of the things I keep saying, and it comes like a cliche, is what I'm about to tell you applies to everyone. But if you have ADHD, it's vital that you do this.
Mm.
Like you said, it's like some people say, oh, we're all on the spectrum. We're all somewhere on the spectrum.
Yeah.
And I think that's true. There's a bit of ADHD in all of us, so to speak.
Yeah.
But it kind of fluctuates maybe from day to day. But people that diagnose with ADHD, they're at one end of the scale. They're at what we feel like the kind of on a bell curve, you got either end of the scale. You got like most people in the middle and people on either, you know, in the extremes.
Mm.
And it's those people that get diagnosed that are in those extremes. And for them, it's like, the way I can describe it is, because some people can't, they didn't like, if they don't have ADHD, they don't get it, because they're like, well, some days I forget stuff and I'm late and I don't want to do something. And I find that really annoying, whatever. But when you have ADHD, it's like someone drawing their nails down a chalkboard when you don't want to do something. And it would reduce me to tears many, many times just to do something I didn't want to do. And even if it wasn't like a really bad thing, or it was just like, I don't really, just can't get that like, it's hard to describe. It's like nails being drawn on a chalkboard.
Yeah.
And one of the things we suffer with is what is called low frustration tolerance. So I think that's a like more psychological way of describing what my metaphor for nails on a chalkboard. It's kind of like I have low frustration tolerance. Here's something I don't want to do, but I have to do it. And it's kind of like, it's like what you would see maybe in a young person or a child having a tantrum because they don't want to do something. So what we often experience is like that, like we may not display it on the outside, but it feels like that on the inside. It's kind of like, oh my God. It's literally unbearable. And then someone could say, well, you're just a drama queen. You're just like overreacting and blah, blah, blah. But I think it's important to understand what's actually going on because, I mean, this is a real condition. It will drive you crazy and it will cause these problems. And if they're unaddressed, then it literally can stop people from doing things, even if they want to do them.
Yeah, that's interesting to think of it in terms of different tolerances and like the ability to control impulses and things like that. There's all these different parameters, isn't there, that our nervous system, it's almost like I'm imagining the controls of a machine and there's all these different dials and parameters that have been set and, you know, and it'll like on an engine or a machine or something, it'll dictate the way that machine performs, you know, like different resistances, different loads, different configuration. Yeah. And I suppose our brain and our nervous system, for whatever reason, just through luck or bad luck or just like things outside our control, we've all got different parameters, haven't we?
Yeah, I agree. And it's not about making excuses for yourself. ADHD is a good explanation, but not an excuse. So it's not about making excuses for yourself. And it doesn't mean tomorrow you're going to wake up and say, you know, I've got ADHD. Tomorrow I'm going to wake up. I'm going to have it all sorted out. That'd be nice. But all of us have challenges in life. It's more a case of, okay, I know now it's better to know than not know. So I know what it is that's going on. I know what my strengths are. And I know what my weaknesses are as well. And now that I have a name for it, I also know where to look and who to go to. You know, what to read or whatever.
It's helpful to put a label on it in some way.
And then it's like, okay, now I know the things that I need to do to manage this condition.
And how does your hypnotherapy help people then? Like, how effective is it?
Okay. So I'll be very honest, on a kind of research level, there aren't many studies that have been done on hypnosis and ADHD because hypnosis has gained a lot of recognition now. But still, ADHD is kind of one of those areas that still, believe it or not, is kind of relatively new. And so for there to be a lot of hypnosis research on ADHD at this stage, it's probably not going to be the case. However, all of the studies that have been done up until now, they all promising. They all show that people with ADHD can respond really well to hypnosis. Now I'm going to let you in on why that is. So some people with ADHD have said, you know, I tried hypnosis, but I just keep waking up. It didn't work for me. What I discovered is this: a hypnosis session really shouldn't be much longer than 20 minutes. Most human beings, ADHD or not, cannot concentrate a maximum for more than 20 minutes. So obviously with ADHD, you should be looking at shorter, right? Now, there was a study done on hypnosis looking at people with ADHD and people that didn't have ADHD. And what they found was that both could be hypnotized and both would respond to suggestions, but people without ADHD had more stamina. That was the only difference between the two groups.
In terms of the duration of the therapy session?
In terms of whether hypnosis works or not, you know, whether they respond to hypnosis. Right. So in other words, people with and without ADHD can be hypnotized. And for example, if we say to you, you're calmer, then you'll experience being calmer after hypnosis, even if you have ADHD. But the main difference that researchers have noticed is to do with how long you can concentrate on the hypnotist's voice.
Right.
Right. So God forbid they see me, I chat forever. but I'll chat fast. If they have ADHD, I can do hypnosis at a faster speed. That's one of my techniques. But seriously. But the other aspect to this is people with ADHD, if you remember, I described their personality as, apart from inattention, difficulty concentrating, they have strong imaginations. That's part of creativity.
Mm.
And they're very sensitive. Now, if you combine those two together, we have a recipe here for a good response to hypnosis.
Oh, I see. So people with ADHD can be more suggestible.
Ah, I'll get to that in a moment. So I don't know if you've ever come across recently more research coming out about showing that people that have strong imaginations are more likely to become traumatized or anxious, that kind of research.
No, I've never heard of that. I'm interested to know.
Yeah.
Tell us.
So I've made parallels here with ADHD. So if someone with ADHD is more creative, imaginative, and often as well, but yeah, I think you said suggestibility and creativity, they can go together, creativity and suggestibility. Hmm. And they're also more sensitive.
Hmm.
So if you put all this together, what it means is, if I was to hypnotize someone without ADHD, someone that doesn't have it, they can respond to the suggestions and imagine things. But if I hypnotize someone with ADHD, because of this, what I call like the stamina, I won't hypnotize them for as long as the person without ADHD.
Mm.
But I could hypnotize them for 10 minutes. But because they have strong imagination and creativity, and because they tend to be sensitive, those qualities will make them respond really well during that 10 minutes.
Right.
So it's kind of like saying quality versus quantity. Now, I'm not saying that people without ADHD don't have a quality session. They do. Maybe they actually get more benefits because they have a longer session. But what I believe is, I have come across a paper where they did actually, that the findings did suggest this, what I'm actually saying as well, that it may be that people with ADHD do respond really well to hypnosis because of these qualities.
Mm.
So, yeah, so you can do like a 10-minute session and that can be as effective as, say, a 30-minute session with someone that doesn't have ADHD.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So this idea that if you have ADHD, you can't be hypnotized, I believe it's a myth. In fact, if you think about it, people with ADHD often space out. That's a classic thing we see in hypnosis, spacing out. So what I was going to say. Oh, I mentioned, some people saying that they listened to hypnosis recordings if they had ADHD and they kept waking up and they believe that, hypnosis doesn't work for ADHD. Well, if we just come back to what I said, that's because the person was listening to a 30-minute hypnosis recording.
Yeah.
Some hypnotherapists release recordings up to an hour long. Mm. I mean, if you have ADHD, you're probably going to be waking up during that hour-long session.
During the first 5 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, I think those kind of hypnotists also probably speak in a slow, monotonous voice as well.
Do you do pre-recorded stuff or is it all live?
Hypnotherapy coaching session is live, but I do give clients recording that they take away, which they listen to at home.
And is it always in person, the live thing, or can you do it over Skype?
Yeah, in person and Skype.
Okay.
Yeah, the only difference on Skype, obviously, is, the normal things. It's... obviously, it's different and they're not in front of you physically, but there's certain things I can't do that I can do in real life with hypnosis. But just like you would have a hypnosis CD and you could be hypnotized from a CD, you can also be hypnotized on Skype similarly, but still on Skype with a hypnotherapist would be better than a lot, lot better than a CD.
Right. So
it's not the ideal scenario, I'll be honest. I think face-to-face is always the ideal scenario, but I won't say I was biased on that, but communication is designed to be face-to-face.
Hmm.
Because obviously most of it is body language and you can't really replicate that through Skype or a computer.
Hmm.
So, all I would do is I can still see the client and I can see if they're breathing, that kind of stuff we need to know in hypnosis. Nothing scary. But basically, for example, when we do hypnosis, when we speak, it's kind of related to the breathing. So little things like that, you know, just being able to see the person, you know, and for example, someone might have their camera up too far, so you can only see their face or whatever, or, you know, so you want to be able to see, you know, their chest so you can see them breathing, little things like that. But I've had good results on Skype. It's hard to say, like, you know, are the results the same as real life? You'd have to run experiments and, you know, to look at that. And I would imagine that there is obviously a difference, but can you get good results on Skype and by through modern forms of communication technology? I believe you can, yes.
And is it a course of sessions or is it just like a one-off or what?
Most people see me for, I suppose the average is about 8 sessions. But it's kind of overall, it's between say 6 up to 12 sessions, most people. With kind of specializing in ADHD, the kind of the model that I created is to kind of like some kind of prep before coaching and then before hypnotherapy. And hypnotherapy is where you kind of go in and you kind of it's similar to coaching. You set goals and you work on them, and there's the hypnosis side of it to help you achieve those goals. But it's not like a classical coaching where it's did you do this, did you do that. It's different. It's more on a subconscious level. So some clients will do the hypnotherapy for whatever, 6 up to 12 sessions or so, depending on them. And then some will still have coaching or follow-up sessions. So coaching for a particular question or challenge that they've got, or their life might change. Maybe they resolve. For example, I talk about my breakthrough in 2011. But as life gets more complicated and challenging, kind of like, you know, like maybe someone wants to go off to university, or maybe someone wants to set up a business, or their business gets more kind of challenging. And, you know, so it's like you'd have a business coach, but you'd have an ADHD coach to kind of help you from the point of view of understanding your ADHD and how that impacts things that you're trying to do. And it's not that, hey, what you did previously didn't work, or, you know, there haven't been any improvements. It's, well, you're kind of hitting another level, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the same as anything else in life. If you were, I don't know, like an athlete, it's like anyone that's top of the game, they would have a chip on their shoulder if they thought, I'm top of my game, I don't need any help now. Anyone that is kind of doing well and is top of the game and really wants to improve, even when they are top of the game, they will also have their coaches and their facilitators and guides and people they can turn to, people that, you know.
Oh yeah, of course, it's not just like a one-time thing, you know. If you're committed, if you've got the resources and you're committed to having a coach, then you know it's an ongoing process, isn't it? You know, you could always do with help,
right? And that's really important as well in terms of things like ADHD, because what I notice within myself, and then I notice it within clients and other people, is they're looking for a magic bullet. So one of the things that helped me to finally like get to the next level happened like it's about 4 years ago, where it was like being hit by a ton of bricks one day. It was partly again another Anthony Robbins, and also Ken Wilber helped me to realize this. You know, like when you know something, but this time it was not intellectual, but like felt within your, like suddenly it clicks like properly. It's like, oh my God, it's not that anything that I've done hasn't worked, or I've gone back, or whatever. I feel like you've gone into reverse, like snakes and ladders. It is, oh my God. It's like Anthony Robbins says, he's had people go on his trainings, you know, like a deep dive 7 days with Tony Robbins, and do his firewalking and all of this crazy stuff, and you feel amazing. And for 6 months, I think one of his friends said this, it was just 6 months, he was on top of the world. And then after that, he went back to normal. And Tony Robbins said, well, you don't think that I just do this once and that's that. He's like, this is a constant thing. You have to have a practice. You have to have a, I have a morning practice. We talked about that earlier. You said, what was my ideal day? And that's part of my ideal day. For me, that practice is keeps me rooted and also keeps me in the flow and moving forward rather than stagnating. Or so, and I believe it is possible to actually lose the advantages that you get through the practices and so on, the changes that you make, because a lot of these changes, they need to be consistent and they need to become habits. That's really what creates a change. There is no magic bullet. There is no do this, order these CDs or this book or do this training or do this and you'll come out and that's it, you've done it. Now you don't need to worry about it anymore. I mean, briefly, and we haven't really gotten to that topic yet, with like the EMF subject, it's like, okay, you find out about that and someone sells you something, says, hey, this will protect you, stick it on your phone and you won't get headaches on your phone anymore. You know, it's probably just a placebo effect. And then the person walks off and thinks, wow, I can go back to using my mobile phone 8 hours a day and not get headaches. It doesn't work like that. You've got to create these new habits and they have to become consistent. And it doesn't mean you've got to be perfect. Some days you might forget and you might have a, you know, and some days you let yourself off. You just have a day where you're just, you know what, just do whatever you want today. But you still got that to come back to, that core. And I think that's the value of a daily practice and having a morning routine. That's big for everyone. But if you have ADHD, it's essential.
Yeah, yeah, makes sense. I know we're going to get onto the EMF topic, but I just want to give out your website in case people want to inquire about the hypnotherapy.
Yeah.
So it's advantagehypnotherapy.co.uk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's advantagehypnotherapy.co.uk and it's ADD Vantage, so Advantage.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
It's a play on words with ADD, obviously.
I see, yeah. Okay, so double D at the start there.
Might have been easier just to go with one D there. I don't know if it's going to how exactly that works. I don't know.
I just had a quick thought. So what you were just saying about like the need for the repetition and bringing it into habit as opposed to it just being like a magic bullet. It reminds me of handstands. Like the secret, because I teach handstands and. Mm-hmm. The secret to it is just doing thousands and thousands of reps. And, you know, and some people come to the class and they think there's like a secret muscle that you engage that makes you be able to balance. And it's weird. A lot of yoga teachers have that kind of like they come expecting that there's some secret thing that if you just do this and then that. And it's really not like that. The secret is you got to be really patient. You got to be and you got to do thousands and thousands of reps for 2 or 3 years, and that's the secret.
I went to a public speaking training a few years ago and there was a quote up on the wall. There's a quote and it was what was it, the law of attraction. You know the law of attraction. A load of people get into this, the secret, the law of attraction. No, I've got into it too. I'm kind of still into it, but it's like that's only an element of it. And and funny enough, in the word attraction has the word action. And like you say, people are looking for that magic bullet, and the reality is the secret is doing it regularly. That's the secret. Anyone that's gone anywhere in life just kept on doing this stuff. And in the process, they learned from it. They made themselves stronger, wiser. They were able to improve their ability to concentrate or to be calmer or organize themselves. You know, that's literally all it is. But it's like, we don't want to hear that. We don't want to hear, oh, really? It's just that. And it's like, yeah, there's this great big marketing thing out there, I guess, to get you to think there's some magic thing.
Yeah.
But honestly, that's the truth. And the sooner you realize it, the sooner you can start to see that progress. And I guess that's what happened with me in 2011 was part of that. It kind of dawned on me then, consistency. Because if I look back then and say, wow, that phase of my life was like crazy productive, like full-time job. I was in basically in a full-time job. I was at the gym 5 days a week, 120 miles of cycling per week. And I was also like doing some meditation classes and stuff like that, like attending them and running my own. And I mean, that's a lot to do in 1 week. And it's like, okay, you've got ADHD, you can't get anything done. Well, I proved that wrong. But part of it was consistency, because I was doing lots of things consistently that would keep me top of my game.
Mm.
But if you were to stop doing them, then you might find that you lose that edge. And funnily enough, that's one of the things that Dr. Rady talks about in a book, amazing book called The Spark. It's how exercise can change the brain.
Mm.
And in this book, I highly recommend it, by the way, Ben, you'll love it. It's kind of like the kind of the biology of what happens when you exercise, but with a bias towards what's happening in the brain. And it's just totally mind blowing. So there's chapters on all sorts of mental health problems, and there's one on ADHD. And he talks about clients he's had that came to him that suddenly get diagnosed with ADHD, but you know, they didn't have it like weeks before. And what happens is these kind of people turn out to be very active, sporty people, like runners and stuff. They have an injury, they see the doctor because they can't concentrate, they got foggy brain, they become disorganized. And the doctor says, oh gosh, looks like you got ADHD. They take medication and all of those symptoms clear up.
Hmm.
And they're like, well, it must be true then. But when these people have recovered their physical health and they've, you know, they've gotten over their injury, they're able to run again. Guess what? They no longer needed their medication.
Hmm.
So one of the things of ADHD is that we have a lot of it's kind of energetic enthusiasm. So we are active people. Without that, things get worse. So if you have ADHD, but you don't want to be active, I mean, it's like,
yeah,
it's like, no, you could honestly, like, embrace your activity, embrace your energy, like use that energy, because actually it's not your enemy. You might have people saying to you, oh, you can't sit still. Oh, you're this, you're that, you know? But honestly, embrace it. It's part of who you are. And if you embrace it, it's actually going to help you. But you do need to embrace it. You need to capitalize on it as a strength of yours. And
hey, I don't want to sidetrack you off into a conspiracy topic, but I'm curious to know what's your point of view.
Conspiracies on here.
Well, I was curious what your point of view is on vaccines and autism. Is there a link, in your opinion?
This is where I end up in court or something and put in prison. Yeah, there's a lot of controversy around vaccination. I have to kind of, all I can say is, I actually, it's not me trying to skirt the issue and ignore it, but I don't know. I will say, however, that it may not be, I think, it may not be as simple as vaccines cause autism or anything else like that. Okay, I think that's one of the things that people got into trouble for. Is this idea that vaccines cause it.
Right.
Now, I think what may be going on, and even this might be controversial for some people, is that there's something about certain people, if they're more prone to autism or whatever, that it's not that vaccines cause autism because of heavy metals or some form of toxicity, but that it could be a contributing factor. That's a possibility, but I don't know, but I personally do feel, from what I've looked at and seen so far, that to say that it causes it is probably in my personal opinion, I can't say definitely because no one knows, but I would say probably incorrect.
It's too much of an oversimplification, isn't it? Just
oversimplification. There was similar thing they said about fluoride, and they looked at that, and a very a psychologist looked at this and analyzed it and found that what they didn't point out was that there was the higher you went up in altitude, then the correlation between fluoride and ADHD started to, sorry, was it autism or ADHD? I think it was autism, started to disappear. So it's kind of like you say, oh, it's caused by this, but you've got to remember there could be a third factor and everything, variables you're not looking at, and you need to kind of separate that kind of soup. And the thing about the Wakefield, you know, situation was that he was kind of promoting that vaccines cause autism, or at least that's what it appeared to be, the argument of those that were against him, saying you're saying that it causes it and that's not true. Now I think I've looked through papers on this and stuff. I haven't seen anything that proves that, but it may be related to it because in some way, but it's not the simplistic thing that we're that people are saying. So let's just bring ADHD into this a moment. So what causes ADHD? I believe that there's a biological element to it. But we also know now that genes can be switched on and off throughout a lifetime. So, for example, if your parents, your family smoke, the children are 40% more likely to develop ADHD. If during pregnancy there is stress and trauma during pregnancy, or if the mother smokes during pregnancy or some kind of toxicity, there's like, again, it's around about the same increase in possibility of ADHD. And there are lots of other things that can increase likelihood of ADHD. I mean, I have seen lots of studies linking increased rates of ADHD and autism with pesticides, and certain ones have been banned, like DDT and stuff. So it depends on which country you're in. So I think in China, some of this stuff hasn't been banned, and I think in America hasn't. And we see some of the highest rates of ADHD and so on in America. Hmm. That might just be a coincidence. I'm not making a claim. I'm just telling you what's out there. And so there are these possibilities. But there are, but what I'm trying to say, there are these lots of these different factors or things in our environment, in our lives, that can increase the likelihood of ADHD.
Hmm.
But so then if you say, well, what causes it? It's not that simple. It's like, well, yeah. So to say that ADHD was caused by vaccinations, for example, I'm not buying that one. To say that ADHD is caused by smoking, I'm not buying that one. Yeah, it can increase the possibility of it, but it doesn't cause it.
Mm.
It's much more complex than that.
I think in a world where people are very quick to make such strong and oversimplified statements, like saying, sure, I don't know, it's complicated, that, you know, there's many contributing factors, is a very sensible
point
of view to have, isn't it?
I know lots of, well, you know me, I originally came off the, I suppose still am in some way, in the kind of the alternative scene. I've looked at this stuff myself over the years, and maybe in believe stuff in the past, but my own, I was asked about the vaccine question once when I first started working with autistic and ADHD children. And I remember the faces of the teachers, and the headmaster said, you're not saying that it causes it, are you? Let me just clarify this. And it was like, oh, wait a minute, I'm about to be strung up like Wakefield. And it was like, no, what I'm actually saying is, it may not be that vaccine causes autism or ADHD, but it may be there's something about particular people they've already got a kind of high toxic load, and this pushed them over the edge, like the straw that broke the camel's back, or they have some kind of tendency, some kind of, they're prone to something biologically, which makes them more susceptible to something that other people may not be. So it's not a direct link. There might be a link. There might be some kind of link, but it's not direct in the way that, say, some conspiracy theories have suggested. Vaccinations cause this. I mean, it's so simple. And like you said, I think a lot of people want, I've had a lot of with some conspiracy types where they get upset and angry where, oh, you're just sitting on the fence.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, well, what, you think I'm choosing to sit on the fence? I'm going to consciously choose to sit on the fence. No, my viewpoints, I can be pretty strong my viewpoints sometimes. I'm not choosing to sit on the fence.
Yeah.
I'm saying I don't know because I don't know. And I really don't think that you know. If you can show me the proof, then go ahead and show it. And then you can claim that you know it 100%. But, you know, I haven't seen it. I've seen claims, but.
Yeah, that's very silly, that kind of point of view. Like, well, if you're not of this point of view, then you must be of that point of view. It's just like false dichotomy, isn't it? It's like, actually, no, it's not as simple as that.
Yeah, I think that there's literally nothing wrong with being on the fence if you don't actually know something. I think it's actually...
It's a great idea to be on the fence if you're not sure.
Yeah, it's good to be honest. You know, I don't know. But you get people get upset that they want you to commit to a viewpoint.
And
if you don't, then you must be on their side. You must believe that then. It's like, no, I'm not saying I believe that. I don't know.
I mean, I sometimes get the same with handstands. Like, everyone's joints and wrists and elbows are all a little bit different, you know? Some, like, most people are fine. They can put their body weight on their wrists and stuff. And then some people are a little bit weaker and they're not as flexible and, you know, they strain themselves more easily. And, like, sometimes, like, people want, like, an answer. Like, what's the solution? How can I fix this? And I've got no idea. I don't know. There's nothing I can do about it. You know, if your wrists are wonky, I don't know, man. Like, maybe handstands isn't for you. You know, that's all I can say.
Yeah, I suppose. Where at the time? I suppose, was it an hour and a half? Your podcast normally?
Yeah, I mean, I'm okay for time. Do you want to talk about the EMF stuff?
Yeah, let's give it a few minutes because I can see like the time there. But I suppose coming back because kind of I suppose we just talked about vaccines now. EMFs, we could kind of get to that one. Hmm. I would say EMFs may be less controversial than vaccines for some reason, but. Okay, so I know Sarah has explained the whole story, so I'm going to keep this brief. So I have had this kind of almost like an allergy with electrical things for at least the past 20 years. When I first had computers and typewriters and stuff as a child, I noticed I would get a lot of deja vu and some kind of spaced out feelings when using stuff. Yeah. When I had my first mobile phone in 1995, when they kind of started to become popular, I had what seemed like a form of petit mal seizure or epilepsy, what they call today localized seizures, like deja vu, a sense of presence, flashing lights, feeling spaced out, all this kind of stuff.
All right. Are those mild forms of reaction? Are they like...
Well, I came across a paper recently by, I think, a Polish doctor, I can't pronounce his name, Pome or something, and he was giving a talk for other doctors and clinicians and saying, look, we've done biological testing on people with this condition, people that have what they call electrical hypersensitivity syndrome. And it means some people are more sensitive to electrical and magnetic fields and radio waves, i.e. that come from mobile phones and radio towers and Wi-Fi. Some people are more susceptible or sensitive to them than others. And so he's saying that they found biomarkers. There's things going on in the body that show that these people, there's something actually going on. Hmm. But I mean, it's always been like this kind of weird topic thing in my life that kept causing problems. I lost two jobs over it and also became homeless at one point because of it. And I would just kind of, like, I didn't have a name for ADHD and I didn't have a name for this, but also this is kind of like where chronic fatigue syndrome was 10 years ago, that it's kind of an unrecognized condition that a lot of people just don't want to talk about and just pretend it doesn't exist. Hmm. And it depends what country you live in. In some countries like Sweden, Canada, like there are countries that recognize it, that it actually exists. And even provide help to people with this problem. But here in the UK, it's not the case. Hopefully things are getting better. But anyway, it started for me, I suppose, that it really became clear was back with my mobile phone. The doctor just said, well, you've got an anxiety about technology, which I think is just palming me off. But anyway, I had endless things that I cannot explain that demonstrated to me that this isn't just a nocebo effect. This isn't just a negative belief. Mm. For example, my mobile phone, I had, now this is going to sound weird. You say, well, if you have this condition, surely you just keep away from technology, you hide in the field. I don't want to hide in the field. but what happened was, so like, I think it was about 2 years or a year after the first mobile phone, I stopped using it. So I went from a Philips phone, and then I had this Nokia phone, like a basic Nokia. When I had the Nokia, I didn't have the symptoms anywhere near as bad as the first phone. The first phone was severe. The second phone was manageable, as long as I didn't make long phone calls. And what happened was, I thought, well, why is it different now? Maybe there's something different about the phones, was one of the first questions that I asked. And I went online, and this is like the early days of phones, but you know, I found out about SAR levels, like the radiation levels on a phone. Hmm. And I discovered that the Philips phone was 1.5, which is what a lot of smartphones would be today. In fact, they can go up to about 2. But the Nokia was a third of the Philips phone. Now, that might be part of the reason. I'm not 100% sure. It possibly could be because it's less kind of radiation per pound of, you know, kilogram of body weight. So that's interesting. But I had that kind of coincidence happened again and again. To cut a long story short, it's been following me around like this kind of dreaded curse that I don't want to deal with my whole life. And it was only basically it's very recent. It was in the last year this became a big deal in my life because I started to develop really bad sleeping problems. And this went on for about a year. I tried lots of things and lots of things helped. And trust me, I've done a lot. I did sleep hygiene. I do all of it. Switch off all your devices 2 hours before bedtime. Use a blue light blocker on your screen so you don't, your brain's not stimulated by blue light, which is just similar to sunlight. Huh. And make sure that your room's dark at bedtime. Face mask, blah, blah, blah. Make sure you avoid chocolate, caffeine. I was doing everything and I was still waking up every hour, hour and a half. One of the things I tried, which seems to help a bit, was melatonin. So I've been taking melatonin. And that seemed to help. But the thing that helped the most, and this was recommended to me by an EMF expert, was, well, why don't you just turn off the electricity in your bedroom? And I couldn't believe it. The first night that I turned off the electricity in my bedroom, I slept super deep like a baby. And I woke up, you know, like you sleep and you wake up and you're like, do you know what? I can't remember being asleep. How can you remember being asleep? Because you're unconscious. But it felt so deep and so refreshing. And I didn't wake up. I slept for the first night, 6 hours continuously. And that was literally like a miracle because I was sleeping maybe 3 to 4.5 hours, then waking up every hour or so repeatedly until I had to get up.
So do you mean switching off all devices, or do you mean actually switching off the electrical ring?
I switch off all devices, no mobile phone on or anything like that in my room, but I also now have the electricity switched off from my room.
What, the actual, like, the mains power supply?
Yeah, so I have it, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you have to install a switch or something, or do you go down to the circuit board and flip it off?
You can do it that way, yeah, and you can install special switches that will maybe just do one part of your house, whatever, so, like, your bedroom. So that's something that would be recommended to someone if you're sensitive like I am. That's something that you need to do if you want to get a decent night's sleep. Now, I've been doing poring over research on this, and I'm shocked. There's an organization called the Environmental Health Trust that have about, I mean, it's run by doctors and scientists, and there's about 22 PhDs out of like 200 doctors and scientists that have been petitioning the World Health Organization since like forever, back in the, you know, well, it's a thing called the Bioinitiative Report, which I think was in 2006 or 2008. And they gave this report and said, look, we now have evidence that non-ionizing radiation does have biological effects. And we also have thousands of studies which show that those effects are also negative. Hmm. The common symptoms, if you're being affected by electromagnetic frequencies, what we generally catchphrase as EMFs, is brain fog, fatigue, exhaustion, memory problems. And what's interesting is in some research with rats, and there was just a big study, sorry, I'm getting muddled up here, but some research with rats show that when exposed to same kind of radiation that we're exposed to, that mostly, and funny enough, male rats, that they can develop hyperactivity. Mm. So you can imagine what I'm starting to think. And suddenly I'm introduced to this whole new world. I'm like, whoa, there's even like doctors and researchers out here that have finding a link between EMFs and ADHD and EMFs and autism. Mm. And all sorts of other health problems. Like, we've had this big surge in what they call like chronic fatigue syndrome, for example, was a mysterious health problem. Mm. Fibromyalgia, ME, there's all these different conditions and new conditions that we're starting to become aware of. And we also know that things that there do appear to be increases in health problems within the population, especially sleep problems. And we know that to get a good night's sleep, you know, you're not going to get a good night's sleep if you were sleeping surrounded by lots of electricity and radio waves. I mean, our bodies go into almost at the opposite state where our electrical activity in our body slows down. So it's all kind of like, and it's like our nervous system is becoming quieter. Well, if you get an EMF detector, like I've now gone out and invested in these myself, I'll switch one on now, but I hear it. So switch it on, obviously have the laptop on. So we're on Skype as well.
What, and it'll give you a reading of the activity?
Yeah, and you can hear it.
Whoa.
And it's on red, so it's on one at the moment. I am still on Wi-Fi. I live with other people, so we have Wi-Fi. But my next step is actually to block out this room, my workspace, so that I'm on the wire and I block out the Wi-Fi. But you could hear it there, and it was the readings was going up to one, and the levels on the machine went into red. So that's like high levels. You wouldn't be able to sleep in that. If you want to sleep, it has to be near the bottom. It has to be at least green on the bottom rung of the dial, which is 0.01 volts per meter. And in fact, even better if it was zero or near zero.
Wow.
Depending on how sensitive you are as well. And they've actually now found biological effects in human in animals and humans way hundreds of times, sometimes thousands of times lower than what, you know, is apparently being that we're being told are safe levels. So this idea that our technology is safe. So let me put it this way. So you talk about a safe level of your mobile phone or whatever. If you go and look inside your mobile phone and look in there and look at the safety on your phone, it will say that this was tested to be 10 millimeters away from your skin.
Hmm.
But how many people, more people are now using a loudspeaker. But if you hold that phone in your hand even, and it's live, so to speak, you're on a phone call, or it's touching and or touching your face, you've already exceeded the safety limits according to the manufacturers. But those safety limits that the manufacturers are talking about are not the levels that peer-reviewed science says are safe.
Right.
They are much, much higher than what the peer-reviewed research says is safe. So according to the science... The safety levels we've got that we have today with our technology, yeah, exceeds the radiation levels by hundreds and some of thousands of times. America, for example, is 900 times, I think it was 900 times higher radiation levels than any other country.
Right.
And it's interesting because we see in America, we see all the obesity and massive levels of ADHD and autism and loads of children taking medications for these disorders. And there's one... was it Dr. Dietrich Klindhardt, a German doctor that has done research? I'm getting a conspiracy here a little bit because he said that he found it difficult to get this particular study into a peer-reviewed journal. He did a pilot study and he took radiation readings from the bedrooms of parents of autistic children. And he found that the levels were 20 times higher than a control group, than people that didn't have autistic children. From their bed. That's interesting. Now, like I said, that wasn't peer reviewed, but here's kind of a bit more to this. So you just know we're not just making this stuff up. Like I said, there's about 200 scientists and doctors that are kind of with the Environment Health Trust that have been petitioning the World Health Organization and that are now again questioning what's going on here, that we need better safety levels and there's concern about 5G. And there are 20,000 studies. When I found this out, it blew my head off. The number of studies is incredible. 20,000 studies which show that non-ionizing radiation can have biological effects on animals and humans. So you will get commonly, if you start to talk about this subject, you will get some pop psychologists or maybe... I don't want to sound here like I'm going after certain groups, but someone that thinks they know what they're talking about and they think you're stupid and they'll say to you, oh, don't be silly. If this was true, like, well, just look up at the sky. There's a great big ball of fire up there. Like there's radiation everywhere. It can't harm you. And the levels you're talking about, it's like, you know, the technology is so low powered that it would hardly affect you. And it's like, no, the level of radiation we now have in the artificial man-made environment that we're living in is I can't figure this out. I'm not a mathematician, but it's a quadrillion more than what it was like before the Industrial Revolution, and we had all this technology came around. And as we go from like 3G to 4G to 5G, and we start to use more and more of this stuff, the levels just get thousands of times higher. So, for example, let's just say, even if it was safe, your mobile phone. If we then sat in a room and we both had our mobile phones, and then someone got a tablet out, which is basically, is I've looked at the levels on a tablet. My tablet seems to be worse than my phone. But anyway, so then you get that in the room, and then you get some laptops, and they all go onto the internet. You've now just added in something that is already way above levels that are actually safe. Yeah. According to peer-reviewed scientific research, you've now got one device, two devices, three, all trying to get on the internet together, and the room starts to heat up with all their combined radiation. And I mean, some people, you know, some researchers have actually done this and measured the levels, and they will now exceed those alleged safety limits at astronomical proportions. You know, we're talking tens of thousands of times potentially higher than what is considered to be safe.
And you could
insane, Ben. We're giving apparently 75% of 4-year-olds have mobile phones. We're giving like I said, tablets, the radiation is basically the same. If you go on Wi-Fi, start watching a video, the radiation level on your tablet is like it would be I don't know exactly, but according to my meter, yeah, it reads in the red on 6 off my tablet, and it would. And I took a phone call on a mobile phone. I was surprised, actually. At the beginning, as you start the phone up, it goes into the red because the phone gets ready for the call and it tries to get a signal. But then the levels drop down to 0.30, which is kind of the average of, say, I measured that kind of level, say, in a house of Wi-Fi at a distance. But I mean, there are solutions to this. I don't sound like I'm trying to scare everyone, but there are solutions to this. All of us need to kind of start to kind of, you know, take this a bit more seriously, be a bit more conscious of how we use our technology. I'm not anti-technology. I'm not saying get rid of it. I'm saying let's use it more responsibly and safely. When we get into a car, what do? We put on a seatbelt.
Yeah.
It's the same thing with this, but we're just, because you can't see it, it's like it doesn't exist. But it does. And what I've found really interesting is I've learned loads just in one day of having these meters to measure electrical magnetic fields and radio waves. And I can pretty much measure everything now. And it's taught me so much about what's going on in my environment. And other people that have seen these things in action have also had their eyes opened. I'm like, wow, is this what we're living in?
So you can literally leave that detector running and like walk around the house and you can see how the level changes, can you?
Yeah, you could switch on your microwave and you'll see the radiation coming out, even though it's meant to block the radiation from coming out, that it leaks out of the microwave. And if you're standing next to it, you're being hit by masses of microwave radiation. We are living in literally in electrosmog. But like I said, I don't want to frighten everyone. I'm a solution-focused hypnotherapist, and I believe in solutions. So we can cut the level of radiation that we're exposing ourselves to by 90% just by doing a few simple things that everyone can do.
Okay.
And I'll tell you how. So first of all, your mobile phone, yeah?
Yeah.
When you use your mobile phone, it's better on loudspeaker, obviously, because you're at a distance. And you can also get special headsets. They're not even that expensive. They're called Air headsets. I can find one from emfields.com. That's run by Alistair Phillips, and he's a top EMF expert in the UK. In fact, he's called in by the government to settle disputes between experts, and he's like the second or third opinion, and he normally shows where they got it wrong and settles the dispute. So this guy can be, you know, he's trusted. And
do you mean like a Bluetooth headset, or is it different?
No. Bluetooth is using similar things. It's low power Bluetooth, but still using kind of radiation. So an Air headset is like a stethoscope, basically. There's no electrical wires. There's nothing metallic in the earphones. So you plug it in and you can take your phone call. And it, yeah, works like a headset, but it's not going to expose you to radiation. In fact, because you can use your phone at a distance and still take the call, you can drop the radiation from your phone by up to, they say, about 98% or so.
Oh, I see. So there's, yeah, it's actually yep. got an air tube, and it transmits the audio down the air.
Yeah. So it's phenomenal. Like that can drop it by 98%. Mobile phone, taking a phone call is one of the most dangerous things you can do in terms of EMFs. But we can do that. And the other thing that we can do is, so when you take a mobile phone call and you've got a poor signal, yeah, the radiation levels on your phone, because your phone is trying to get and keep that signal, it will put out more radio waves trying to grab the signal. Mm. Yeah. It will power up and make more effort. So what you can do is, you really should, really ideally should only ever use your mobile phone and make a phone call outdoors. If you can't do that, only make your phone call where you get a good reception.
Hmm.
Because then you can drop the radiation levels by 100-fold.
That's
a lot. Yeah. And I proved this today with my meter, that when I had my meter and I took a mobile phone call, I was expecting it to go into the red and stay at red. It didn't. It went up to red at the beginning of the phone call as it charged up and got ready for the call and tried to make the connection. Once it had the connection, the levels dropped down to 0.30, yeah, which was roughly what I saw with Wi-Fi at a distance, which I can withstand Wi-Fi at a distance pretty much. So that's a lot better than it hitting six going into the red, yeah. You know? So there's little things you can do that with your mobile phone. The other thing you can do is you can put on airplane mode when you don't always need it like that, and just avoid it being in your pocket. So yeah, little things like that you can do. And the other thing that will make a massive difference is your Wi-Fi. Now, people think that you need to have your Wi-Fi on all the time. No, you don't. And I used to hear people saying, oh, if you switch the Wi-Fi off at bedtime, it will make the router like won't last as long. Now I'm hearing people saying, now stuff come out saying, oh, actually, it's good for your router. So anyway, let me tell you the truth. Put your health first before your router. switch it off at bedtime. And what you're going to do is you're going to basically drop your radiation levels massively, and you're going to have a better night's sleep. And that's important for everyone. It's especially important if you have, say, for example, people with ADHD or have really bad sleep. And same with autism, they tend to have really bad sleep. And one of my theories around the EMF connection and ADHD and autism is that because they're more sensitive, they also are more sensitive to electrical and magnetic fields and radio waves. And what is commonly prescribed to children and sometimes adults with ADHD and autism are commonly prescribed melatonin. Melatonin is released by the pineal gland in the brain, and it releases that when it's dark. Now, there was a BBC documentary years ago about this stuff when it all first started coming out, and about EMFs and mobile phones and Wi-Fi, and it had a lot of people talking about sleep problems. Now, we know that sleep problems have rocketed. They rocketed when blue light came out. And until people knew that blue light was keeping them awake, they didn't know. But once they started to get rid of their blue light and you know, that next to your bed or whatever, and you know what it's like. When the mobile phones came out with the blue light on the mobile phone, oh, wow, it's got blue light. Oh, it looks really funky.
Yeah.
But they were causing sleep problems.
Right.
Scientists discovered that it's a certain radiation of blue light was keeping people awake because it's stopping your melatonin from releasing from your pineal gland.
Oh, we see. So that melatonin gets released when you sleep at night, does it?
Yes. So it stands to reason. We've got people being sleep problems increasing, and you've got people with ADHD and autism taking melatonin to be able to sleep. Well, why aren't their brains releasing that naturally?
Mm.
Well, one of the things I've explored is the connection between, because they have a poor sense of time, is the where do we get time from? Like the basic way that we understand time before clocks. Before we could even think about time, you know?
Mm.
And you know, if you go to Glastonbury or some hippie town, they still celebrate this stuff, like, you know, the solstice and, you know? And people worshipping the sun and the moon. We get our sense of time primarily from the sun going up and down. And when it gets dark, we know it's bedtime. We know it's dark. All animals, because we're animals, are dying to go to sleep when it gets dark. But now we live in this artificial environment that there's lights on telling us to stay awake.
Hmm.
And so this connection with ADHD is they're more prone to seasonal affective disorder as well, which is to do with the sun or the lack of light in the winter. And they have a poor sense of time and they're more sensitive. And my theory is that these things are connected. So we are more sensitive maybe to electrical magnetic fields. And if we don't sort that out, it can affect our sleep because our brain won't release melatonin. Now, I believe this applies to everyone, but some people may be more prone to it than others because it's like they have a more sensitive neurological system for some reason. Some people seem to adapt to these things more than others. But here, though, is the rub on this, and a warning, really, is some people will think, well, because I can't feel the effects of this energy, I can't feel my mobile phone doesn't give me a headache, or I can't feel Wi-Fi or anything like that. I'm not sensitive like these guys.
Hmm.
Yeah. They'll think, well, I can carry on using my phone 8 hours a day. Hmm. Or I'll carry on having the Wi-Fi on at night, even when I'm trying to go to sleep. I've literally had some clients, for example, turn up and tell me they've got sleep problems. And I've said to one, I said, what do you do? How do you relax before bed? And they said, well, me and my missus, we sit up in bed and we go on our phones, scroll and just chill out. And I'm like, okay, have you heard about blue light? And sometimes this stuff obviously falls on deaf ears. But literally, getting into bed and going on your mobile phone before sleep, and you're telling me you've got sleep problems, you're waking up in the middle of the night and you can't sleep, and you've got anxiety. Well, there could be a possibility that that because you're exposing your brain to blue light directly before sleep, and you've got ADHD, so your brain is potentially more sensitive. So then is it any surprise that I suggest that your brain may not release melatonin, so you're waking up in the middle of the night? It's a very simple solution to it, is just don't use your phone or any kind of screen with blue light an hour or if you're very sensitive, 2 hours before bed. And the other thing you can do as well, if you really must use it, get a blue light blocker like Twilight or Efflux. But I would say even then, even if you're not sensitive, you need to at least stop using screens a minimum of 1 hour before sleep. But like I say, if sensitive, then 2 hours.
My iPhone's got that thing where it'll reduce the blue, like, at night. Does that help a little bit, or is it sort of...
That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, no, that's on my laptop. Yep, you can do it on there. It'll go into that mode. Mine automatically does it at 8 or, well, sunset. It'll start to go into, like, a orangey kind of color.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's kind of what I'm talking about, yeah.
Okay.
But I hope that's just illustrate that, you know, this whole EMF thing is not crazy, and that it, I think some of us don't want to talk about or think about it because, well, we're using our technology and I don't really want to think about this, or it's everywhere. Now, here's where I'm going to get myself shot, and it might sound like a conspiracy theory, but it's not. People can go and look at the research themselves. There's 20,000 studies that show that non-ionizing radiation, the type that we're dealing with, does leave biological effects. Yeah. So what is silly about this is it's like X-rays, gamma rays, and all these other types of radiation. Yeah, they're bad for you, right? But it just so happens the frequencies that we're using to do your technology, oh, they're okay.
Right.
I'm not saying that I'm not like some people think you're scared of radiation. I'm not afraid of the sun. Yeah. I'm not trying to protect myself from the sun. But we all know if you sit in the sun for too long, you'll get sunburn.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a matter of levels and exposure, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah.
It makes no sense to say one thing's good or bad. It depends what level you're dealing with, isn't it? Right.
Exactly. That the scientists aren't saying this. There's research showing that certain frequencies of radiation can be good for your health. So what we're saying is it's the levels. That's primarily what we're talking about here. And there are ways to kind of reduce the levels. There are such things as low radiation modems and stuff like that. And I've also heard about, what's it called? What's it called now? Oh, Wi-Fi. So Li-Fi. there's this idea that we can create the equivalent of Wi-Fi, but it runs on light, which most researchers, they don't know because they haven't done any testing on it. It's even less tested than the stuff we're dealing with now. But based on the science, what we know about energy, about electromagnetic frequencies generally, that it should be safer than Wi-Fi. So that's interesting. There are these new possibilities. But we need to kind of think about these new possibilities, and we need to take action on it, or otherwise we'll just carry on as we're going. Now, what's interesting is, now we're sounding more like a conspiracy here, but if you go and look at the research, 70% of studies, and there's about, what's it, around about four, there's more like, getting around more like 5,000-6,000 now, that show negative biological effects on humans, yeah, and animals. 70% of those. But when you look at the funding, 70% of studies that are from independent researchers find this negative correlation. But when you look at these studies done by the mobile phone companies, you'll find the reverse. 70% of their studies that they funded, say that there isn't any negative effect. Now that's damning. It's like reverse numbers, and it looks just like when we had smoking industry and asbestos and all these other kind of things we've had in the past. So it's crazy. And part of my mission now is, it's been scary for me, because I thought if I talk about this, people would just like try and, you know, but there's like, I'm starting to feel less like that now. I just come out of the woodwork on it and said, well, no, you know, what am I scared of? At the end of the day, there's this research sitting here. There, for example, there was a big study done by the National Toxicology Program, and that was actually funded. Here's one that doesn't really fit the pattern, because this is one that is kind of unique in this sense, because kind of what I said earlier, this kind of this study apparently had received some funding that was kind of related through kind of official channels. So this is really interesting, but this should be in some ways more damning than the other stuff. So $25 million they spent on a 2-year program exposing rats to radiation levels like those that we're exposed to through our use of mobile phones. On a daily basis. And what they found was they're at higher risk of brain cancer. So that came out, and this is $25 million study over 2 years. And there's an institute in Italy, Ramazzini Institute, that replicated their study. So these are big studies over long periods of time, take a lot of money. They got the same results. But the ICNIRP, the Council of Non-Ionizing Radiation, they said, they basically looked at this and decided not to take any action. And they're petitioning the World Health Organization yet again to move it from possible carcinogen. So our technology is, the radiation in our technology is classified as 2A, possible carcinogen. They're saying, on the basis of the overwhelming amount of evidence we now have, it should be a 2B probable carcinogen. But they haven't taken this on board. They haven't made any changes. This is unfortunate, and this just shouldn't be happening. But it is. You have these two major studies, and they're just kind of like acting as if, well, it's rats, not humans.
Yeah.
But we know that we have humans out here that do have health problems that appear to be related to the same source. So, and there are, like I said, there's lots of practitioners out there and doctors and so on that are helping people and acknowledging this really does exist. So I believe that, you know, it's time to stop burying our heads in the sand. As much as we might be dependent upon this technology and the effort it might require for us to put pressure upon the industry, because probably nothing will change unless we do put pressure on them to recognize this. And I think we do have to go towards to the industry, the mobile phone companies, and we do need to start as consumers, put pressure on them, say we want safer technology. And we've educated ourselves and we know all this evidence sitting there. You're not telling us about it, but we know about it. Yeah. Mm. And let's do something about it. But until then, until the safer technology comes out and this change comes about, I think we need to start at home. We need to start with what we can do to protect ourselves and our children. And really, children is my biggest concern, because they are most, children, elderly people, and certain sensitive individuals, or people that have health problems, they're going to be more prone to the effects of EMFs. So it's quite a minefield, and I'm on this big health journey now with that. And I just wonder how much of my sensitivity to EMFs is related to ADHD. Because interestingly, when I decided to specialize 2 years ago, the first person that came to me for coaching, they too had the same problem that I have. They said that they've been moving from one, you know, place to another. They were living in shared places. They were quite young, so they're living from one place to another, moving from one place to another, because they literally couldn't sleep at night, and they had realized that they were having this reaction to their mobile phone and to Wi-Fi and all sorts of stuff, even baby monitors. And then it puts some people, you know, that are in a boat like this, puts us in a very weird very confusing and scary place, because it's like, well, it's not recognized. What do you do? I mean, yeah. And there's a lot of people walking around that don't even know that they're even harmed by this. Like I said earlier, don't think because you're not sensitive that it means you can sit on your mobile phone for 8 hours talking without a problem, because in a way, it's maybe potentially worse for people that aren't sensitive, because if you're sensitive, you'll walk away from the source of the problem. Mm. Whereas if you develop health problems, and some of these health problems can take months, if not years, to develop. Recently met some people that told me, well, I've met many people over the years that have told me that they've slept with their mobile phones underneath their pillows and their phones are switched on as well. And one of these persons was telling me that they had sleep problems. And they got upset when I suggested not to sleep with their phone underneath their pillow, explain why, and thought that I was dismissing all of the other aspects of what might be causing their sleep problems, such as doing night shifts and stress at home, whatever. The way this works is called the load phenomenon. We can be stressed by all sorts of toxins and pressures in our environment and our lives, and they all add up together. So I'm not saying it's just your mobile phone underneath your pillow that is stopping you from sleeping, but it's bound to be a factor, and probably a big factor, because you shouldn't have your mobile phone that underneath your pillow next to your body like that, next to your brain for that length of time. That's insane. And I'm only telling you this because I care about this and about you. And, you know, I mean, if it was your child or your nephew or your niece or something, and they were doing that, I mean, surely we have a responsibility to say to them, it's not good practice. Do not sleep with your mobile phone underneath your pillow. But I hope most of the readers here aren't doing that kind of thing, and have already probably got that far and realized that. That's just an example of what happens when we aren't educated on this stuff and when we can't see it. There you go.
Well, a lot of that was new to me. So I've definitely heard you make references and terms that, you know, I wasn't aware of. If people want to look up that device, what's it called?
Device? What do you mean?
The detector.
Detectors, EMF detectors.
Yeah.
Well, where I got mine from is it's emfields.com. And this is a guy in the UK. It's Alistair Phillips. Like I said, he's like the top EMF expert in the UK, and he's often called in as a like second or third opinion, or some even a fourth opinion, when there's disputes like tribunals around radiation. Say like you were working in an office place and you got ill, or maybe even lots of people working in an office became ill, and they said, well, maybe we need to check the lighting or the electrics, and they said no, there's nothing going on, or you know. And then he's come in and he's the guy that kind of like seems to sort it out. Mm-hmm. So he's well respected, even by the authorities that apparently don't recognize a lot of these things that I've talked about today, but they do recognize it to a certain degree. Mm. Yeah. Mm. The dispute is over the safety levels. And like I said, according to scientific evidence, the safety levels that apparently aren't safe, and just to double up on that, they're even less safe when you start using multiple devices in the same room, and so on and so forth. But he has a range of detectors for, so I got one for electrical and magnetic fields. So that's all like your wiring and your laptop and even your cooker. And it also does magnetic fields. And so then you've got also what's called Acousticom 2 or electrosmog detector, which starts at 200 megahertz, goes all the way up to 8 gigahertz. So it's one of the highest ranges on the market, and you won't find many that go that high, certainly not around this price range as well. I mean, they're not cheap, these things, but from what you can do with it is amazing. I've learned tons in just one day from having these meters. Like, I found sources of radiation that I didn't know existed, coming from some, haven't figured out where they're coming from yet, but there's some kind of tower or something. And it was kind of raising the levels a bit in my sleeping area. But now I know how to sort that out. And I also found out that some of the things, the changes I've made, and 29 positive changes I've been making to help myself with this, so I can recover from this condition and be able to use technology safely. What I've done is I now have my laptop plugged in. Not plugged in, on a battery, not plugged in. And I have an external keyboard and a mouse that is an old-fashioned mechanical mouse. And I've just checked it with the meter. I felt better with this setup, but with the meter, I checked that when you unplug it and you're on the battery, the electrical readings drop from red very high. The maximum reading on the monitor, they drop all the way down to green, safe levels. Mm. So, and the mouse doesn't have an electrical charge, and neither does the keyboard. So it's confirmed what I suspected, that it is a better setup for me. Because where a lot of my problem comes from is the number of hours I might spend at a computer. But that's made a big difference. And the other thing that I've done is I've got, like an old-fashioned word processor that just runs on a couple of AA batteries. And I tell you what, Ben, that's absolutely made a massive difference, not only to my sensitivity, because I'm now away from Wi-Fi by using that. Mm. But I can use that anywhere. I've done a little bit of an article or blog or whatever or whilst traveling or whilst cooking, all sorts of places, like randomly. Right. And the other thing is... you don't have the level of distraction with that as you would if you had some form of modern technology. If you were writing on your computer, there's always the possibility you might get distracted and go on Facebook or check or have some windows open or say, oh, I'm doing some research, but actually you're avoiding what it was that you were there to do. Hmm. So it's a great efficiency tool, and it's really retro. It's really cool. I love it. and it's like, loads of professional writers still use these things.
Right. Okay.
Which is really cool. So, yeah. You know, so sometimes going back, old school, is actually a step forward.
Yeah. I used to have that with guitar amps and stuff. I used to play guitar and just using quite a simple setup, just with the valve amp and maybe a couple of just individual effects pedals, just like an echo pedal and a wah-wah pedal and nothing else, and just keeping it simple. But then there was there was these big pedals that were computerized, and they had processors, and it was really complicated. And yeah, you know, there was something much nicer just by using a vintage kind of simple setup.
Felt you get easy. That. Yeah, funny. I don't know if it'll be like that for people in the future. They might be using this laptop today, and then at some point, 10 years from now, that becomes some kind of ancient object.
Yeah.
And this was the laptop or the tablet during my youth, and it brings back that nice feeling. But I don't know. I don't think it's just that. I think there is something about the kind of about simplicity in life.
Yeah.
Like, you know, reading from a book rather than trying to read off a screen, or just when you're doing something really simple, like just chilling out, out in nature or having a bath, lighting with a candle burning. Like, it's just simple stuff, just has a different effect on us. For example, when you're on a computer, especially if you have windows open, and you're doing different stuff, your brain's darting from one thing to another. And it is literally like the ADHD brain. It's like it simulates the ADHD brain. But when you then get like a little old word processor, or even some writers use typewriters, you're kind of like, if you take away all of your technology and you're there with your typewriter or word processor, it's like you're forced to do one thing. It's right. And it also makes you more mindful, because you kind of, on my word processor, you can only write about four lines. You can only see four lines at a time. So you feel like each paragraph is, I don't know, my paragraphs have become shorter, let's put it that way. Since
I've been... Right.
It has it's been really good. It's like all these things. It's challenging. It's like, you know, ups and downs, but like the process is going through the process of these things is absolutely wonderful. So, and you learn a lot. So, and grow a lot from it.
Well, so. Jamie, it's been a great conversation. So thanks for all that information. It was really informative.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it.
I'm going to put your link to your website, so if people want to get in contact, they can.
Yeah. We might as well mention now before I go is I put on an event as well. It's called the ADHD Solution. And that's what the seven steps to mastery, as I call it, which is like all the seven things that I think are key to recovering and even mastering ADHD. And like you said at the beginning, a lot of these things apply to everyone, which they do. So you could even attend if you don't have ADHD. Try to recover from this ADHD culture that we live in. Come along to that. It's really, really cool. And I share all that stuff with people. And the next one is the 26th of January. Saturday, 26th of January in Bristol. But if you go to my website, you can find out about that.
All right. That's awesome. Well done with all that. That's fantastic.
Yeah. So great speaking to you.
All right, Jamie, I'll put it all up and it'll be online today and I'll send you the links.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. It was great.
You're welcome. All right, take care. Speak to you soon.
Yeah, and you. Take care. Bye-bye. Speak soon. Bye-bye.